Spring Data JPA's repositories provide most of the database operations for you. That makes working with Spring Data JPA very comfortable, but it also increases the importance of a good logging configuration. If you don't implement your database operations yourself, you at least need to make sure that you know which operations get performed. The best way to monitor all executed SQA statements during development is to use the right logging configuration for the persistence provider used by Spring Data JPA. The persistence provider does all the heavy lifting. It's responsible for executing all queries, detecting and persisting dirty entities, handling caching, and providing lazy loading for managed associations. And it's also the best component to measure and report all these operations. When using Spring Boot, Spring Data JPA uses Hibernate as its persistence provider by default. So let's take a closer look at a development configuration that provides you with the necessary insights and a configuration for production that keeps the overhead as low as possible. Hi, I'm Torben Janssen. Welcome to another video. If you want to build incredible efficient persistence layers with Hibernate and Spring Data JPA, please subscribe and click the bell to get new videos every week. And also don't forget to like this video if you found it helpful. When implementing a new feature or fixing a bug, your log file should tell you about all the executed SQA statements, cache interactions, and other operations your persistence layer performs. When using Hibernate, you can get all of this by activating its statistics. You do that by setting the property spring.jpa.properties.hibernate.generateStatistics in your application.properties file to true. And when doing that, you should also set the log category logging.level.org.hibernate.stat to debug to not miss out on any available information. Hibernate writes a log message for each query executed by Spring's repositories based on these settings. At the end of each transaction, it also summarizes all performed operations. Let's try this with a simple test case that gets all chess player entities from the database and writes a log message with their first and last name. Spring Data JPA's findAll method generates a simple query that selects all chess player entities. As you can see in the log output, Hibernate executed that query and wrote the statement, its execution time, and the number of returned rows to the log file. And the block of session metrics gives you a quick overview of all the performed operations. In this case, Hibernate prepared and executed one JDBC statement. The 19A2C puts reported in the metrics tell you that Hibernate added 19 objects to the second level cache. And Hibernate also performed one partial flush at the end of the transaction. If I would have activated JDBC batching or triggered more operations on the second level cache, you would see that in the session metrics as well. Based on this information, you can check if any potential problems might cause trouble when deploying your application to production and using it with a bigger database. In addition to Hibernate statistics, you should also configure a threshold for Hibernate's slow query log. Hibernate then measures the execution time of each executed SQL statement. If it exceeds the configure threshold, it writes a log message with the execution time and the executed statement. Let's rerun the same test case and check the log output. Using this configuration, you get all information you need to understand which operations Spring Data JPA executed and how your persistence layer interacted with the database. If you want to get an additional log message for every executed SQA statement and more detailed information on Hibernate's operations on the second level cache, you should also set the configuration properties logging.level.org.hibernate.sql and logging.level.org.hibernate.cache to debug. Here you can see the entire configuration for development systems. When you deploy your application to production, you should already know how it works internally and which operations it performs. Now it's time to reduce the logging overhead to get the best performance. You do that by not setting the property spring.jpa.properties.hibernate.generateStatistics or by setting it to false, and by setting the log level of org.hibernate to error. Hibernate then only writes a log message if an exception occurs. Spring Data JPA adds another layer of abstraction on top of your persistence provider. That makes the implementation of your persistence layer much easier. But the abstraction also makes it harder to understand how your application uses the database. This increases the importance of your login configuration. Using the right configuration, you get all the information you need to find, analyze, and fix potential problems during development. You should use a different configuration to avoid any overhead in production and get the best performance. Okay, that's it for today. If you want to learn more about Spring Data JPA, you should join the Persistence Hub. It gives you access to all my video courses, including a detailed one about Spring Data JPA, 2 monthly Q&A calls, monthly coding challenges, a community of like-minded developers, and regular expert sessions. And if you like today's video, please give it a thumbs up and subscribe below. Bye!